Danny and I immediately had a connection, a musical connection, like a language we both spoke fluently to each other.
We often use the analogy of a sculpture. So if I start a piece of music and he sends it back to me, I say, no, you need to put that back, otherwise the cello sounds crappy or whatever.
Danny has classical background, which I don't really come from. And then I have a DIY self-taught background. So we kind of complement each other in that way.
My name is Danny Bensi.
My name is Sander Jurjans.
And we scored the music for A Murder at the End of the World. I was raised in England playing the cello. I also grew up in a house with musicians. My parents were super encouraging.
I grew up in Seattle, going to go see those bands, Soundgarden, Pearl Jam, Nirvana. My dad listened to quite a bit of music. He listened to a lot of classical music. You know, I was big into the metal and rock stuff with my brother, and then I was getting this other side of it.
In middle school, I wanted to learn the drums because it was way cooler than the cello. My mother wheeled and dealed with me to make sure I didn't stop playing the cello, and it was a really great move because I've got the cello sort of classical side and then this sort of rock thing, and I use all of that every day.
I never learned kind of to read music. Actually, in my 30s, I buckled down and learned to actually play piano because I use it so much for scoring. I went to Rhode Island School of Design. And my roommate, he was best friends in middle school with Danny. And when I learned he was a cellist, I thought that was the coolest thing ever. I had never played with a cellist.
Actually, soon after we met, he had a show with his band Groovus Malt, which was sort of a prog rock something band. It's hard to describe.
Prog rock is progressive experimental rock. Bands like Yes and Rush.
Him and I just immediately started to click. The rest is history. We moved to New York together.
When I first got to Brooklyn, I was working multiple jobs.
We called it the grind, right? It's you work and then go home and try to do what you love and eat somewhere in between and have some beers too. That was our existence for a long time. I think the fundamental building block of the score, I think, is electronic synth-based, but we don't really like such clear synths and clear, smooth sounds. Like, I love all this dilapidated distortion, and you've got this clear rhythm, it's not too heavy. And then what can we do when they arrive in Iceland, for instance, with strings to sort of flourish? Very minimalist approach.
And so we wanted to have this sense of haunting in the music, and the voices were, you know, a way of doing that.
Sort of like ha 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 and things like that, and little breathing techniques that made it sound almost percussive.
And we had this kind of instrument we could play on a keyboard or a program. So we could create these clusters of voices that were things that would be impossible to sing.
One of the first pieces, or first cues, has what I call sort of the love theme. It's just four notes. The first time we hear it is when the camera is coming down and going into the window of this motel. Now, the music underneath, without the melody, it's kind of bringing the audience into the first episode, and we see what's afoot. As we sort of start panning in, their ghostly melody of four notes is heard way in the background, and it's just enough for the audience to kind of clock it. But you're not going to hear it until later.
Another thing is, you know, for this score, we did a lot of dumping stuff we had recorded onto a tape deck and then creating cassette tape loops. Turn it into this kind of weird loop that's kind of warbly and strange. And it's extra messed up because I made it. You know, you can buy made tape loops, you know, cassette tape loops, and then you just pop it in there and do the whole thing. But we really love kind of taking it all the way back and like figuring out, how do we do this? How do we make this so that it's just ours? We treated A Murder at the End of the World in the same way. It's really like sitting down and improvising for a good couple of weeks.
You gotta start somewhere and then be able to build on it. Like, I don't know, what do you feel like playing today? I don't know.
Honestly, we really tripped into this business. There was like an accident.
We didn't know anything really about the movie industry, except that we love movies.
When we thought of film scoring, we were like, oh, it's that, you know, you have an orchestra and you have the screen and you have that green dot going across the screen with the tempo or whatever. There's no way we can do that.
I was like, there's people for that. Composers who studied it and write full scores on score paper. And
then we started kind of doing it our way, which was creating these textures and ideas from very little.
I imagine like this consortium of composers that are looking down over the newcomers. Like, oh, you're not ready to come into this world. You don't deserve to be here.
People ask us sometimes, like, what advice would you give a young composer? And our advice usually is forget everything you know, because you know all the stuff you don't know is an asset to what you